Hare Krishna. Of course, Vaishnavas are usually very generous, but Vaisheshika Prabhu, your leader here, is one of the most active promoters of book distribution. We all get inspiration from his dedication. So very happy to be here, but as we all know, this is a long weekend. Not only is it a long weekend, the weather seems to be pretty good also. And it's a long weekend and good weather, what do people do?
Enjoy.
So anyway, it's nice to be here. We were in Berkeley yesterday and today here. I was going to read a verse from the Bhagavatam that describes how a devotee, what should be the qualities of a devotee. You like to hear that?
Okay.
We'll do a short kirtan. I have a bad throat, but we'll. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
If you'd like to welcome everyone to the program this evening. This is a long weekend, am I right?
Yes.
People look forward to long weekends.
Yes.
Why do people look forward to long weekends? They look forward to not only long weekends, they look forward to any holiday. Am I right?
Yes.
Long weekend they're very happy. Regular weekend they're happy. Single that day, they're happy. Why are they? Why is it? Because nobody really is enjoying the work he's doing. No one really enjoys it. We go to work, we go to office, we do business because we need money to survive and facilitate so-called sense enjoyment. So when there's a holiday, it's a departure. We look forward to it. But in spiritual life, you ever look for holidays? You ever say, oh, it's a long weekend, and I'm going to chant my nose. It's a long weekend, and I'm going to chant my nose. No. For devotees, every day is a day of devotional service because they enjoy executing devotional service. Devotional service is Pavitam Sushitama Vyayam. It is the purest process, it is happily performed, and it is inexhaustible. In other words, you can serve day and night and not get tired. So we're going to read today a verse to you from the third canto of the Bhagavatam. It's Lord Kapila, the explanation about the process of devotional service. We want the exact words on the screen?
Yes.
We want the exact words. It doesn't matter. So we'll just read the translation in purport, okay? At the same time.
Canto 3, Chapter 29, Text 18. Translation. A devotee should always try to hear about spiritual matters and should always utilize his time in chanting the holy name of the Lord. His behavior should always be straightforward and simple. And although he is not envious but friendly to everyone, he should avoid the company of persons who are not spiritually advanced. In order to advance in spiritual understanding, one has to hear from authentic sources about spiritual knowledge. One can understand the reality of spiritual life by following strict regulated principles and by controlling the senses. To have control, it is necessary that one be non-violent and truthful, refrain from stealing, abstain from sex life, and possess only that which is absolutely necessary for keeping the body and soul together. One should not eat more than necessary. He should not collect more paraphernalia than necessary. He should not talk unnecessarily with common men. And he should not follow the rules and regulations without purpose. He should follow the rules and regulations so that he may actually make advancement. There are 18 qualifications mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, among which is simplicity. One should be without pride. One should not demand unnecessary respect from others. And one should be non-violent. Amanitvam adhambitvam ahimsa. One should be very tolerant and simple. One should accept the spiritual master and one should control the senses. These are mentioned here and Bhagavad Gita as well. One should hear from authentic sources how to advance in spiritual life. Such instructions should be taken from the Acharya and should be assimilated. It is especially mentioned here, Nama Sankirtana Cha. One should chant the holy names of Lord, the holy names of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Either individually or with others. Lord Chaitanya has given special stress to chanting of these holy names of the Lord as a basic principle of spiritual advancement. Another word used here is Arjaveena, meaning without diplomacy. A devotee should not make plans out of self-interest. Of course, preachers sometimes have to make some plan to execute the mission of the Lord under proper guidance. But regarding personal self-interest, a devotee should always be without diplomacy, and he should avoid the company of persons who are not advancing in spiritual life. Another word is Arya. Aryans are persons who are advancing in knowledge of Krishna consciousness, as well as in material prosperity. The difference between the Aryan and non-Aryan, the Sura and Asura, is in their standards of spiritual advancement. Association with persons who are not spiritually advanced is forbidden. Lord Chaitanya advised, Asat Sangha Tyaga, one should avoid persons who are attached to the temporary. Asat is one who is too materially attached, who is not a devotee of the Lord, and who is too attached to women or enjoyable material things. Such a person, according to Vaishnava philosophy, is a person non-grata. A devotee should not be proud of his acquisitions. The symptoms of a devotee are meekness and humility. Although spiritually very advanced, he will always remain meek and humble. As Kaviraj Goswami and all the other Vaishnavas have taught us by personal example. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that one should be humbler than the grass on the street and more tolerant than the tree. One should not be proud or falsely puffed up. In this way, one will surely advance in spiritual life.
Hare Krishna. So we are celebrating Independence Day weekend. Yeah. What was significant on July 4th? America got independence in 1776, nearly 300 years ago. So this reminded me of Prabhupada's encounter with his spiritual master. Prabhupada was born in a spiritual environment. His father had trained him from a young age in spirituality. And at the age of 7, Prabhupada was organizing the Rath Yatra for children. And in 1921, he had a friend who had told him, there's a very special sadhu in Calcutta. I want you to come and meet him. Prabhupada said, I have met so many sadhus. I'm not inspired by them. Because Prabhupada's father would regularly host sadhus. He did not discriminate what their background was. And when these sadhus would be leaving, he would just tell them, please bless my son, that he becomes a great devotee of Radharani. That's all he wanted in exchange. So this friend of Prabhupada told Prabhupada, there's a very special sadhu. I want you to come and meet him. Prabhupada said, I have met so many sadhus. I'm not inspired by any of them. I don't want to meet anyone. But he insisted. He said, no, this sadhu is special. In Prabhupada's words, he virtually dragged Prabhupada to meet this sadhu. So Bhakti Siddhanta ji, in the very first meeting, would see, here is a young man who can fulfill Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's prediction. What was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's prediction? What was it? Prithipati Achidata Nagradigram. That was the Pracharana we want to know. In every town and village of the world, the holy name will be chanted. And the acharyas try to fulfill that. So Bhakti Siddhanta ji, following in the footsteps of Thakur Bhakti Nava, Thakur Bhakti Nava had sent a book on the life of Lord Chaitanya in 1896, the year the Prabhupada appeared, to universities around the world. And he had prayed to the Lord that a successor would appear who can carry his movement forward. He was praying for a ray of Vishnu. And Bhakti Siddhanta ji appeared in a very auspicious manner, thereby revealing that he, the child, in response to the prayers of Thakur Bhakti Nava. And Bhakti Siddhanta ji had sent some of his sannyasi disciples to England, to Germany. But they came back without much success. But nevertheless, Bhakti Siddhanta ji did not give up his efforts. A devotee keeps endeavoring. He doesn't give up. So when Prabhupada met his spiritual master for the first time in Calcutta in 1921, Bhakti Siddhanta ji could see, he's a young man. He spoke very good English, who can take Lord Chaitanya's message. But he said, you are an educated young man, take Lord Chaitanya's movement to the Western countries. Prabhupada at that time was very active in Mahatma Gandhi's, which movement? Independent freedom movement. And Gandhi had introduced many schemes like boycotting everything British, boycotting university degrees and so on. So Prabhupada was very active in that. So Bhakti Siddhanta ji, when he said, you're an educated young man, take these teachings to the Western countries. Bhakti Siddhanta, Prabhupada said, first we should make this country of India independent. Once we make India independent, then people will listen to our message. Now who will listen to our message? And what was Bhakti Siddhanta ji's reply? Who knows? Real independence is independence from the cycle of birth and death. Political independence is not real independence. Real independence is a cycle from the birth and death. And Prabhupada said later, I was defeated by my Guru Maharaj. And so Bhakti Siddhanta gave us the real meaning of independence. We talk about political independence, economic independence, isn't it? Just like England became independent of the EU. So it's the headlines all over the world. But that's not real independence. Real independence is becoming independent from the cycle of birth and death. And that is possible and attainable if you follow the advice in this verse. So let us see what advice Kapila Deva is giving. Kapila Deva, as you know, is an incarnation of the Supreme Lord. and Lord Kapila there has been explaining in great detail through his mother Devahuti to all of us about the process of devotional service. And Kapila there has explained the Samkhya Yoga philosophy. But his mother Devahuti, she was self-enlightened. She's mother of the Supreme Lord. She doesn't need any enlightenment. But the questions that are asked in the scriptures are more for our benefit. And if we study the scriptures, we will see it's nothing but questions and answers. Just like in your school days, you usually use books with questions and answers. So, Parikshit Maharaj is asking questions. There's a Parikshit Maharaj in the first canto. He inquired, what should one do with one to die? And this question is a question that we should all be asking. Parikshit Maharaj had a great fortune that he had 7 days notice. We may not even get 7 seconds notice, as Prabhupada often we should say. So, in the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is asking so many questions. Am I right? Just like in the fourth chapter, Krishna gives a history of the Gita. Krishna says, I imparted this knowledge to the sun god Vivasvan, who in turn imparted it to Manu, and who in turn imparted it to Ikshvaku king, the king in whose dynasty later God Ram appeared. So Arjuna heard this statement, but then Arjuna knew that in future some people may challenge this and say, you guys believe in Krishna? Krishna said he imparted the knowledge to son called Vivasvan, but Vivasvan appeared before him. So how is it possible? So Arjuna said, how do you want me to believe that you imparted this knowledge to the sun god and he's seen it to you by birth? And what did the Lord say in reply? Many, many times, both you and I have appeared. Many, many times, both you and I have appeared when I can remember all my previous births, and you can. So, so asking questions is nothing uncommon, nothing embarrassing, but we should be asking questions from the right source, from the right authority, so that we can get proper guidance. Just like if you want some medical surgery to be done, you don't catch a man on the street and give him a knife and say, do the surgery. You make sure that the person is well qualified. So similarly, when we are seeking knowledge, we should also go to the right authority. So, just like in the seventh canto, King Yudhishthira approaches Narada Muni and says, please describe how can one in the household and ashram attain perfection based on Vedic principles. And then Narada Muni gave a reply. So here in this chapter, Devahuti is continuing with her question. Earlier, she has already questioned how can she progress spiritually. Devahuti said, you are my transcendental eye. Just like we see through the eyes, Shastra Chakshus, we see through the eyes of the scriptures. Our own material eyes are limited. We see through the scriptures. So similarly, she said, you are my transcendental eye. Please describe to me knowledge, how one can become free from the cycle of birth and death. So in this chapter, Devahuti has said, you have explained the science of Samkhya Yoga. Now please explain to me the science of pure devotional service and the role that time plays, because time virtually destroys everything. Is that true?
Yes.
Time plays a major role. You may have seen a picture of yourself 40 years ago, 50 years ago, and say, this is how I looked 50 years ago. But time, but time makes sure, sorry, that everything gets destroyed. So Devahuti's question was, please describe how one can render devotional service so that we can free ourselves from the calamities of birth and death. And please describe how time acts. So Kapila Dev is giving advice how to execute devotional service. And everyone sitting here is interested in devotional service, am I right?
Yes.
Otherwise you would not be here. It's our experience that the many temples in every city, but those who get connected to ISKCON are the ones who have interest in devotional service. So you want to hear what Kapila Dev says?
Yes.
He says, a devotee should always try to hear about spiritual matters and should always utilize his time in chanting the holy name of the Lord. Hearing about spiritual matters is recommended again and again. What is another name for hearing about spiritual service? Krishna Katha. So this point that we should hear about spiritual subject matters gets repeated again and again. Shravanam and Kirtanam. Prahlad Maharaj's father was very angry with Prahlad's teachers. What were their names? Sarada and Marada. You are not watching my son properly. It appears that the Vaishnavas are coming in disguise and brainwashing my child. And they would say, sir, we are Brahmanas. Don't chastise us for nothing. We ourselves are Brahmanas. But don't worry, we'll brainwash your child. So they went to the father and said, now we've done our job. If you wish to, you can test your son. So the father made the son sit on the lap and asked him, amongst the various subject matters you have learned from your teacher, which is most important? He expected, father, you are supreme. But instead, what did he hear? The ninefold process of devotional service. Sharanam Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam Father Sevanam Anshamudam Dasam Sakyam. When he heard this, he was so angry, he lifted his son off his lap and threw him on the ground. So hearing spiritual subject matters is repeated again and again. Why is it repeated again and again? Who knows why? Why? Because we tend to forget. Our memory is very short. We need to be reminded again and again about the importance. That's why, if you read the Bhagavatam from beginning to end, the same theme gets repeated, only the approach varies. The theme of devotional service, hearing and chanting. So hearing and chanting about spiritual subject matters is vital. This begins with are chanting the holy names of the Lord. In the Upadesha Amrita, Rupa Goswami gave us many wonderful books. At one time, Rupa and his brother Sanatana were virtually running the kingdom of a very powerful Mahavira ruler. But then, first Rupa and then Sanatana resigned from government service and joined whom? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave both of them instruction on devotional service and guided them to further write books to further write books on the science of devotional service. So Rupa Goswami gave us many books and we follow them. That is why we devotees are also known as Rupanugas, those who follow the Siddhanta given by Rupa Goswami. So in Upadeshamrita, which Prabhupada has translated and presented as next of instruction, Rupa Goswami says, the holy name of the Lord is sweet like sugar candy. The pastimes of the Lord are sweet like sugar candy. The qualities of the Lord are sweet like sugar candy. Everyone loves sweet things.
Yes.
That's why in every meal, in the end is the sweet. But in Gujarati meals, it's the other way around. Sweet in the beginning, and the rest in later, am I right? And that thing have changed. Okay, so everyone loves sweets. So we love sweets. That's why so many people have diabetes now. But anyway, if you eat sweets, your dentist friend will love you. And the more sweets you eat, the more cavities you get. So anyway, he says, the holy name of the Lord is sweet like sugar candy. So the holy name is sweet, so we should be chanting all the time. But there's one problem. What is that problem? There's a disease we are suffering from. What is that disease? What does Rupa Goswami say? Disease of avidya. Avidya means ignorance. And how does ignorance manifests itself through the anarthas, such as lust, anger, greed, envy, hatred. These are all the agents of avidya. So Rupa Goswami says, due to the presence of avidya, we can't taste the sweetness of the holy name. We hear the holy name, we hear about the importance, but then we ignore it. So now the next question may be, if the disease of avidya is so powerful, do we have any hope? Or we have no hope? What's the answer?
Yes.
Yeah, hope?
Yes.
Really? What's the
hope?
Rupa Goswami says. First he says, the holy name is sweet, the qualities are sweet, sweet, the pachams are sweet. Then Rupa Goswami says, but we are suffering from the disease of avidya, so you can't appreciate the sweetness of the holy name, pastimes, etc. But then he gives you the solution. You will see in the Vedic discussion, first the problem gets identified and then the solution is presented. Many times in material existence, you will say, the doctor may say, this is your disease. And you tell the doctor, doctor, what's the cure? Sorry, no cure. But in spiritual life, the disease gets identified and the cure is given. Just like Rupa Goswami has given you the disease. Now he gives you the cure. He says, if, however, you attentively chant the holy name, then the disease of avidya will get cured and you will appreciate what? The sweetness of the holy name. So the holy name is all sweet. The passions of the Lord are all sweet. Over here, Kapila Dev is recommending that a devotee should constantly hear about the glories of the holy name and the passions of the Lord. But there's an obstacle. The obstacle is identified as avidya. So if we tend to be healed, then this disease can be cured. Bhakti Siddhanta Ji was very impressed by Prabhupada's sincerity and how attentively Prabhupada would hear. Prabhupada, sometimes devotees would ask Prabhupada, how do you preach so enthusiastically? And Prabhupada would say, because I heard attentively. Bhakti Siddhanta Ji would say, this boy hears attentively. So he will also preach enthusiastically. So attentive hearing of spiritual matters is highly recommended. And Kapila Dev is saying, here about spiritual matters, the devotee should utilize his time in chanting the holy name of the Lord. Utilization of time is another important issue. Chanakya Pandit. You heard of Chanakya Pandit? Everyone? He was a prime minister who lived very, very simply. The king discovered that this man of wisdom is living in our heart. The king told him, I will build a palace for you. But what did Chanakya Pandit say? He said, no, thank you. I prefer living in a hut. He didn't want to take an obligation and then they have to agree to everything the king said. But Chanakya Pandit has given us very good wisdom, and Prabhupada used to often quote Chanakya Pandit. But Chanakya Pandit has said, Ayusha Kishana Ekopina Navasana Kotipe. A minute lost cannot be made up with the wealth of the entire world. So time has to be utilized very cautiously. Time is very valuable. If we want to save, we can get something $20 cheaper in a store 10 miles away, you would not mind driving. You don't mind. But time, don't worry. The Bhagavatam says, with the rising and setting of the sun, the duration of everyone but one who uses his life in service of the Lord is being reduced. The time should be utilized correctly. Time is of the utmost value. Yeah, if we lose $10, we feel sorry. But how much time we are losing? And we should refrain from idle talk, prajalpa, and utilize the time productively. Time is your most valuable asset. And the human life should not be wasted. Famous Vaishnava poet, Dhruvam Das says, Manushya Janma Paya, Radha Krishna Hai Bhajiya, Jhaniya Shunya Pisha. Having obtained this rare human birth, and not having worshipped Radha and Krishna, I'm simply drinking poison uselessly. So we should take interest in spiritual subject matter, discuss Krishna Katha. And is there a shortage of material with regards to Krishna Katha? Is there? Just like these days, this year, 2016, is very significant. Why? 16. 15th anniversary of Prabhupada's incorporating his code. So there are many super manners we hear, but we can also discuss. Prabhupada's life. Last year we celebrated the golden jubilee of Prabhupada's departure from India on the Jaladuta. Jaladuta became very famous in this world. Unfortunately, that ship was crushed. Like normally when these planes and ships become very old, they are crushed and sold as crap. So unfortunately, the Jaladuta had become old, and 30 or 40 years ago, it was crushed and sold as crap. But if it wasn't, the owner said they would have made a lot of money. But Jaladuta has become such a famous name in ISKCON that everyone would have said, come on, I want to buy a piece of that metal for $10. So, last year we celebrated the golden jubilee of Prabhupada's departure. And this year we are celebrating the golden jubilee of Prabhupada's opening the first ISKCON temple and incorporation of ISKCON. Devotees around the world are planning special events. So this is a great topic to meditate. How Prabhupada struggled. Prabhupada was ordered by his spiritual master in 1921 to take the teachings of Lord Chaitanya to the Western countries. Only because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had predicted that. And Thakur Bhaktivinoda, I believe, the day after tomorrow is the did the parents say? Thakur Bhaktivinoda is considered the mercy incarnation of the Lord. Nama Bhaktivinodaya Sachidananda Namlin Gaurashakti Durupaya Rupanta Gaurayana. So Thakur Bhaktivinoda was a great visionary who could see that the Vedic message has fallen in wrong hands, and it was due to his efforts that the pure teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu were established. And he had full faith that that Lord Chaitanya's prediction will come true. So what did he do? He wrote a book on the life of Lord Chaitanya. In 1896, what was 1896 significant for? What? Prabhupada's appearance. And he sent it to universities around the world. And his successor, Bhakti Sinhavati, continued the effort. So Prabhupada was ordered in 1921 to take his teachings to the Western countries. And as you know, Prabhupada had to struggle. But he never gave up. There was a time when he had no permanent residence. But he never gave up. He went on persisting. And then finally, he was able to print the Srimad Bhagavatam. And after he printed the first canto of the Bhagavatam in three volumes, he was even more determined to go to the Western countries. And he was approaching people for help, and one of the acquaintances helped him. So from this is a great topic of discussion, how Prabhupada was so determined to carry out his Guru's order, and how he eventually succeeded. And then he established his cause. Prabhupada, when he was sailing on the Jaladuta, on the 13th day of his voyage, he had a heart attack. Then he had a second heart attack, but not major. And he was thinking, my mission will not be successful. I should go back to India. But then he had a dream in which the Lord and the demigods were in a boat, pulling the ship, Jaladuta, in which the Lord told him, don't worry, your mission will be successful. So we can see in Prabhupada's life how he was determined to carry out the spiritual master's order. And he did not give up. And he had left India with just 40 rupees in his pocket, which at that time was equal to $7. When he came to the West, he virtually knew no one. Prabhupada was lecturing in a college in Butler called Slippery Rock College. And Prabhupada gave a lecture. After the lecture, he asked a question. He was so impressed by the questions presented by the Americans, and he decided now he should go to New York and start preaching. And even though he virtually knew no one, he did not get scared. He had faith in the instructions of his Guru Maharaj. And he went on endeavoring. And finally, on July 13, 1966, what did he do? Registered ISKCON. When he was registering ISKCON, some people in New York suggested, he called the society International Society for God Consciousness. Prabhupada said, God is not specific, it's vague. We will call our society International Society for. And then he subsequently opened the first temple in New York. It was a storefront. And prior to ISKCON renting that storefront, there was a boutique over there. The tenants had vacated that storefront. And that boutique was called Master's Gift. Everything was cleared in the shop, but they forgot to rub that name out. And when the devotees saw that, Master's Gift, they concluded, yes, that is Krishna consciousness. Master's Gift is Krishna consciousness. A gift cannot be matched by anyone. We may get so many different types of gifts. You know, people love gifts, isn't it? In America, you have Daddy's Day, Mommy's Day, Brother's Day. So these are all days. So on Daddy's Day, you give presents. Everyone buys a present. On Mother's Day, everyone buys a present. So then, and if somebody gives you a gift, you feel happy. But what is the real gift that we should be hankering for? That is, and that's a real gift that should be given to others. That's why Prabhupada encouraged book distribution. And your temple here led by Vaisheshika Prabhu is one of the leaders in book distribution. But this is the matchless gift. These books contain wisdom And these books contain wisdom, and this wisdom, if applied, can save us from the cycle of birth and death. Bhakti Siddhanta Ji, Prabhupada met his spiritual master in Radhakund in 1935. Bhakti Siddhanta Ji drew a picture of a mridanga and said, if Krishna ever gives you a facility, print and distribute books. And this is called Brihad Mridanga. The mridanga that has a loud noise. An ordinary mridanga can only the sound, can only travel to a point. But you distribute a book in San Jose, and someone could read it in some other part of the world. Years ago, in the early days of our movement, our devotees had gone to an African country for preaching. So when they were there, they met some local African devotees. The devotees said, we know what you're preaching. We are already preaching that message. And they were stunned. They said, we are the ones who have come here to preach. How do you know what you're, how do you know what is our message? They said, we were studying in England, we bought the books. We were so impressed by the books, we came here and started preaching. So the books were distributed in London, and the preaching was being done in an African country. So that's why this innumerable examples. Someone will get a book in one part of the world and read it in another part of the world. I know cases where somebody had a book. For 4 or 5 years they didn't even open the book. I know a case where somebody had a devotee. He lost his job. He was depressed. So he went to his mother's library, started reading books on different topics. Finally, he got his hands on the Bhagavad Gita. Started reading the Bhagavad Gita. And that Bhagavad Gita was purchased by his mother about 6 years ago. So for 6 years, the book was just lying on the shelf. Finally, someone read it and became a devotee. So that is a real matchless gift. When Prabhupada started the Hare Krishna movement in New York, those were the days when the Vietnam War was going on and a lot of Americans were taking drugs. You don't want a drug? Yes? No? Okay. Okay. In this part of the world we have to do. Even in India, drug abuse today is so widespread. So anyway, people take drugs, why? They want to feel high, isn't it? So the devotees, they made a pamphlet which said, chant Hare Krishna and stay high forever. You understand? You take normal drugs, intoxication, you feel high for some time, but then you again come back to the ground reality. That there's misery and nothing but misery. Whereas, if you chant Hare Krishna, then you stay high forever. So this Krishna consciousness is a matchless gift that enables you to stay high forever. So what Kapila Dev is saying, utilize your time in hearing about the glories of the Lord. And we were making the point, there's so many ways how we can engage ourselves in cultivating Krishna consciousness. And one of the ways you can do is discuss Prabhupada's life, how Prabhupada struggled to fulfill his Guru's orders, how he came to America, still he was struggling, how he eventually set up ISKCON and opened the first ISKCON temple in New York. And today there are temples virtually in every corner of the globe. How many temples is this going to have? Who knows? Okay. There were 650 temples around the world. This includes the Namahats and Bhakti Riksha, the many parts of the world where we do not have temples for various reasons, political reasons, but the preaching is going on through Namahats and so on. So, engage in spiritual discussion. Then Kapila Dev says, one should be straightforward. That is the quality of a devotee. Straightforward and simple. Our philosophy is simple living and? And what is the material philosophy? High living, simple thinking. No, not no thinking, simple thinking. What is high living? First question is, what is simple living? Simple living means you simplify your bodily needs. Materialistic society means everyone's competing with everyone. In American English, they call it living up with the Joneses. You heard that before? They don't use that phrase so much now. Living up with the Joneses means I must be a step ahead of my neighbor. If my neighbor has a BMW, I should have a Mercedes. If he has a Mercedes, I should go for a Rolls Royce. So, make a step ahead. If they call it, as Prabhupada used to say, the rat race. In a rat race, does anyone really win? No one wins in the rat race because they're all rats. So, simple living means you minimize your bodily needs in simple living so that you can focus high thinking. High thinking means what? High thinking means understanding. I have this rare human body and I can see that this body is giving nothing but trouble. Is that true or false? You may think that all the medical problems are in countries like India and Africa and America. You know, the world has a very exaggerated picture of America, thanks to Hollywood. So, you would think that, in America there will be no misery. But having come to America now, are you experiencing there's no misery here? Are the hospitals lying vacant? Are the doctors eagerly waiting for the next customer? No. There's as much disease now as ever before. Our scientists may say, they'll be able to conquer diseases. They may conquer one disease, but another one crops up tomorrow. So high thinking means there's misery all around. I should do something to get rid of the miserable body. So simple living, high thinking. That is our philosophy. And in contrast to this, the material philosophy is high living, simple thinking. Beg, borrow, steal. Which of the cars you see on the road are all finest cars. And think simply. Simple thinking means thinking with the animal. So a devotee is advised again and again to lead a simple lifestyle. And further it says, avoid envy. Envy should be avoided. In mature life we are all envious of each other, am I right? A becomes envious of B, B becomes envious of C. Avoid envy. Look at the good qualities in everyone. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the Lord appearing in the role of a devotee. people were envious of him also. And there was one Moga, son-in-law of Sarvabhaumacharya, was very envious of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would be invited for prasad in different homes. And then they would say, come and eat for 1 week. And Mahaprabhu would eat for a day or two. Anyway, once Sarvabhaumacharya and his wife were serving Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And this Amoga was very envious of the Lord. He would stand with his ears glued to the wall, very cautiously hear what the Lord was speaking, just to find some mistake that he could broadcast to the world. One day, his Sarvabhaumacharya had to leave the entrance to help his wife in serving the Lord. The Buddha just went inside and saw all the big offerings in front of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Shh! So he started saying, look at the sannyasi, pretends to be renounced, but is eating more than a householder. Later on, this Buddha got infected with a very severe disease of cholera. Lord Chaitanya went to him, placed his hand on his chest and said, as long as envy is there, the Lord will not decide over it. So generally we should avoid envy. If someone has some abilities or qualities, you're happy to know that. If somebody has those abilities. And if we keep maintain envy towards each other, our own spiritual life will get affected. And it says, friendly to everyone. Lord Kapila Dev describes the qualities of a transcendentalist. Because Devahuti had inquired, how can I become free from the cycle of birth and death? And the Lord said, by devotional service. She wanted to know how to execute devotional service. He said, by associating with a saintly person. She wanted to know what are the qualities of a saintly person. So Lord Kapila said, Surdham Sarva Dhenam. He is friendly to everyone. So the devotee of the Lord is a friend of everyone. Even if someone criticizes you, still maintains a friendly attitude. And because the devotee of the Lord is a well-wisher of everyone. Prabhupada, when he would sign his letters, he would say, your ever-well-wisher. So a devotee is a well-wisher of everyone. That's why he endeavors to give people Krishna consciousness. So Kapila Dev is saying, the devotee should be friendly to everyone and he should minimize his association with non-devotees. It is impossible to live without associating non-devotees. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, two important slokas. One sloka is Sadhu Sangha Sadhu Sangha Sarva Sangha Ava Mata Sadhu Sangha Sarva Sangha. If you want to make spiritual advancement, mold your life in such a way that you can regularly get spiritual association. Then it says Asat Sangha Tyaga Vaishnavachara. Minimize the association of non-devotees. So Kapila Dev is making the same point. But at the same time you'll see, we can't live without associating with non-devotees. You go to work, you do business, you go to school, even when you go to preach. You go to preach to whom? Non-devotees. You have to associate. But the association with them, only to the extent necessary, and not beyond. So association plays a big role, association, and great influence on the lifestyle that we develop. If you associate with good devotees, you'll get good influence. If you associate with fault finders, that'll also influence you. Therefore, association is very important. And Prabhupada designed his con in such a way that you have so much opportunity to associate. You have so many leaders traveling and preaching, and then you have Prabhupada books, you have devotees, the Sunday program. Prabhupada, as soon as he opened the Sun First Book Temple in New York, he also started the Sunday program. And Prabhupada would personally cook the Sunday feast so that people would be attracted. So the point we're trying to make is, in our ISKCON society today, we have ample opportunity for Sadhu Sangha. We get that in the Sunday program, which is like a mini Sadhu Sangha festival. And then you have the Mayapur and Vrindavan festivals. In Russia, we have many big Sadhu Sangha festivals. And one of the festivals that you may have heard, the Black Sea Festival. And in that festival, about 7,000 devotees come every year. So the point is, there is ample opportunity for us to engage in Sadhu Sangha and thereby rejuvenate ourselves. Sadhu Sangha, spiritual association, results in rejuvenation. And that is necessary if we wish to make spiritual advancement. So what we have presented today is nothing new. Was there anything new in what we presented? It's nothing new. The same point gets repeated whether you're reading the first canto or the 12th canto. Vyasadeva is reminding us again and again about the important elements of spiritual life. Regular hearing is a must because we are so conditioned that we easily forget. And in Kali Yuga, our memory is weaker than ever before. True or false? True. We virtually have to write down everything, isn't it? And thanks to these smartphones, you can write down very easily. These smartphones are a blessing and a curse. Am I right?
Yes.
They're a blessing for the sincere. Now you can carry all the Prabhupada books in your pocket. Who could dream that a day would come and you could put all the Prabhupada 80 books in on a smartphone? But, so that's a positive side. You have all the Prabhupada books, you have access to darshan of many deities, you can store unlimited number of pictures of the deities, etc. And the downside is, you can also misuse the smartphone. You can misuse it in watching pornography and all that crap. The devotee's mentality is to use everything in service of the Lord. So we hear these things again and again because we realize hearing is the beginning of spiritual life, the maintenance of spiritual life, and the end of spiritual life. There's never a point where a devotee can say, I don't need to hear, I don't need to chant. When Haridas Thakur was told, you're now in bad health, you can reduce your chanting. He said, I can't. So, we should constantly be here to be here. Hear about the glories of the Lord, hear about the passion of the Lord, hear about the mission of the Lord, and hear about Prabhupada's struggle to establish ISKCON. And we are so fortunate that Prabhupada gave us the pure message of Godhead. And if we apply this pure message of Godhead, we will be able to experience what? Ananda Buddhi. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, the many benefits of chanting the holy name. One benefit is Chaitanya Paramarjanam. Your heart gets cleansed. Then another benefit is Ananda Buddhi. You can realize unending spiritual pleasure. Material pleasures have a beginning and an end. The spiritual pleasure is unending. So let us take to Krishna consciousness seriously. Lord Rishabhdev, in instructing his son, says, Tapo Devya Putagayana Sattva. My dear sons, perform austerities for the pleasure of the Lord. In exchange for this, he will realize unending spiritual pleasure. So let us take to Krishna consciousness with full enthusiasm. Rupa Goswami says, if you want to succeed spiritually, you should be enthusiastic and at the same time determined. Both of these are vital if you want to make spiritual advancement. So we hope that you take advantage of what Kapila Dev said. And by meditating on Kapila Dev's instructions, we will be able to make progress on the spiritual path. Hare Krishna. I don't know if it's 49, but I can take on some questions if you have. Are there any questions? Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Thank you so much for keeping us in your orbit. We feel rejuvenating just by your presence, and I am from the bottom of my heart very thankful for giving so nice instructions. I had a question that in the
instructions were given by Kapila Dev. Very nice reminding you.
Thank you. In the purport, Prabhupada mentioned that devotees should not be interested in self-interest should not be there and without diplomacy. So can we little bit elaborate like how in duty circle also we can come to this diplomacy part unknowingly and how to avoid that?
The point is, as Kapila Dev said, the devotee should be straightforward. Diplomacy can also be used in the service of the Lord. Just like Raghunath Das Goswami's father, Govardhan Majumdar, and Hiranya Majumdar. He was a Mamlin king, was after them. And they were hiding. So the king arrested Raghunath Das. He said, tell me where your father and uncle, otherwise we're going to hang you. So Raghunath was in a very delicate position. So Raghunath said, my father and uncle are like your brothers. One day you fight, next day you embrace. So Raghunath preached to the king, the Mamlin ruler, in such a diplomatic way that his tears came from his eyes and he gave up his anger and released Raghunath. So diplomacy, like many times when, you know, I've been involved in preaching in countries where ISKCON was banned, but we had to be very diplomatic in how to present Krishna consciousness. So diplomacy in service of the Lord is okay. What is wrong is being duplicit. I tell A something, I tell B something, I tell A. And you know what happened? The guy was criticizing you so badly, I defended you. And then he got to be and said, Prabhu, I'm always your friend. I mean, duplicity means double talk, as they say. That's what we should avoid. And if we commit a mistake, we should acknowledge it. I made a mistake. Sometimes devotees ask, if I offended somebody and I apologize, will that be the end of it? If you offended someone, and he apologized, then you have done your duty. If the other person doesn't reciprocate, that's not your hand. You have done your duty. So, the devotee should be straightforward and truthful. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna gives the austerities of the tongue. One of the austerities of the tongue, he says, is to speak words that are truthful. Okay? Any more questions?
So sometimes, says in ISKCON, like, we have distributed enough book, but we don't have enough leader. So let's focus on creating leader than distributing books. Can you share your view on
that? Could you repeat that?
Sorry?
Could you please repeat your question?
Sometimes, some leaders say that we have enough distributed books, because like 50 years has been, and so many books has been distributed, but we don't have enough leaders. Especially in USA, we see that is the scarcity of leaders. So let's more focus on creating leaders than distributing books.
We should focus on both preaching and book distribution and working leaders at the same time. Sometimes devotees say, I don't feel advanced enough to distribute books. Isn't it? So when I feel advanced enough, I'll distribute. You will become advanced by distributing books. Because as Krishna says, those who preach my glories are very dear to me. So we recognize we are short of leaders. The whole material world is short of leaders today. You know that? Look at the two candidates who are running for US elections. So the whole material world is running short of leaders. But as we distribute more books, we will give more people an opportunity to become devotees. And many of them may have leadership qualities. But ISKCON is working on both. We have several programs now to train up leaderships. We have a GBC college in Bombay where talent is being identified and sent for training. So it's not that we're just focusing on book distribution. We're focusing on several aspects at the same time. One of them is devotee care, taking care of devotees, taking care of devotees in old age, and so on, especially those of dedicated brahmacharis and brahmacharinis who have dedicated lives who don't have anyone to look after them. So the society feels obliged. And we're also trying to train up leaders. But we can't say, till we have enough leaders, we're not going to do book distribution. That has to go on. Prabhupada was doing book distribution, and he was a one-man army. Prabhupada was translating books, publishing books, distributing books, doing the fundraising, one man. Prabhupada then say, I won't do book distribution till I have thousands of leaders. And his books created leaders. Okay. Any other questions?
Thank you, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
One question.
Yes, that's
Let's
right.
Let's pass the microphone quickly.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for the wonderful discourse. One question I wanted to know is how, there are several parameters, but what are some of the most important parameters by which we can measure our progress in Krishna consciousness? The reason I'm asking this question is, it seems overwhelming the amount of anarthas in the heart, of course, that's like accumulated over many, many lifetimes. But at least if we can measure the progress, it will help us to have some hope. And
just like when you have a high fever, what do? Put the thermometer to check if the fever is coming down or not. So we also have our thermometer, we're seeing whether I'm advancing spiritually or not. And what is our benchmark? How attached am I getting to the holy name? How attached I am to getting a purvi? How attached am I to getting observing good sadhana? How attached I am to following Ramayana principle? How attached I am to serving Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis? Very often we have pride. I don't want to serve everyone and everyone serve me. But Prabhupada in today's purport also said, one should be humble and meek. So how attached am I getting to the concept of serving devotees? So these are all criteria. And then another criteria is, take the help of senior devotees. Dadati patigranati. If really your mind is those are more advanced. And if other Vaishnavas give you some guidance, take it if it's for your spiritual benefit. See how attached am I getting to the holy name. This is more important. If you get attached to the holy name, then your spiritual success is guaranteed. Is that clear?
Thank you.
And how attached am I getting to the process of hearing? Hearing is very important. It's not that when I sit down to do japa, I fall asleep. I see when I sit down to hear the class, I fall asleep. Have you ever seen anyone falling asleep in front of a prasadam plate? I haven't seen. I regularly go to the prasadam hall and see devotees eating prasad. I've never seen anyone. They may complain, prasad not good, it's too salty, too spicy, too oily. But I've never seen anyone falling asleep in one of the plates. So same as that's the attachment you should get to the holy name when you're sleeping and chanting, hearing. It means I have no attachment. That's an obstacle that we have to overcome. Yes?
Maharaj, in your lecture you were talking about Prabhupada, and you said that how much Prabhupada put so much of hard work and effort in writing those books and distributing it and in starting this movement. So you had a first-hand experience of Srila Prabhupada at that time. So my question is, can you share your realization with Prabhupada, and what made you to become a full-time preacher and leave a illustrious material career that you had? So can you just share your personal realization?
Well, that's a hard question to answer. Well, what a bad cold. I had a fortune of meeting Prabhupada in Montreal. I had come, like the others, to make a fortune in Canada. And I was studying to meet Prabhupada. I could see he was very sincere, genuine. And that's what attracted me to join his movement. It was very pure. And Prabhupada wanted everyone to join because he was supremely compassionate. That's the nature of a transcendental plan. He was so compassionate. Even if somebody insulted him, he still would bless that person. I remember a program in which we participated. Somebody had insulted Prabhupada. But still, he called that person and blessed him and begged him to take to Krishna consciousness. So he was not on any egoistic platform. He only had one point of mission to save humanity. So getting connected to Prabhupada's movement, we should have a similar mood. Okay? Any more questions?
I'd like to thank His Holiness Gopal Krishna Swami one more time. Maharaj, before we finish here tonight, we have a small request for you. Your presence at IXB this year is very timely, as we are just concluding our monthly Sankirtan festival in honor of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. His disappearance day is the day after, on Monday, 4th of July. And we have been having a campaign to distribute as many Bhagavad Gita as possible, literally thousands or tens of thousands throughout North America. And since you are here on this long weekend, where we're just concluding our MSF, we have a small altar set up here with Bhagavad Gitas, and we request you to kindly say a few words so that devotees present here would feel inspired to sponsor and contribute to this campaign.
Actually, fortunate other souls who have the opportunity to preach and sponsor these books. Krishna says in the 18th chapter, the dearmost person to me is one who preaches my glories. There will never be one more dear to me than him. Here, in your sample, there's a temple led by Vaisheshika Prabhu. The devotees are constantly reminded about the importance of book distribution. And you take part in various marathons. Bhaktivinoda marathon, this marathon, that marathon. Isn't it? Why? Prabhupada was once asked, what's a marathon? Prabhupada, marathon means less sleeping, less eating, and more preaching. So, the devotees are on a marathon all the time. And sometimes some of you may say, hey, what is this pressure? Every few months is a marathon. Isn't Maya on a marathon?
Yeah.
Or Maya slows down sometimes?
No.
Does Maya slow down?
No.
Is that Jose? A few months a year, I'm not going to disturb anyone. Maya's on a 7x7, 24 hours marathon. So we should also counter it. And distribution of Bhagavad Gita can be done in various ways. One of them is one-to-one, and the other is we sponsor. Many times people say, I want to see the books distributed, but I don't have the time. So I'll sponsor, you go ahead and distribute them. So we have an opportunity for everyone to engage in preaching. So this is the Thakur Bhaktivinoda Marathon. Please sponsor these Gitas. Need our sponsorship?
Yes, Maharaj. We'll make a quick call for sponsorship tonight.
What, tonight?
Your presence. Just a few minutes, since we're already approaching Advaita Chandra Prabhu. Two cases for Bhagavad Gitas. $108 for each case. 24 Bhagavad Gitas, soft Gitas.
Advaita Chandra and his wife Sita Thakurani live in Los Angeles, Orange County. They're very active in book distribution there, and they try to promote book distribution everywhere. here in St. Mother also. Thank you very much. More?
Yes. Vijay Damodar Prabhu and Mukharvinda Prabhu, we have two hands raised. How many? Two cases. And two cases also from Mukharvinda Prabhu. Harshal Prabhu, one case. One case, Rajendra Kumar Prabhu. Trisha Prabhu, one more case. Two cases. Including company match from Tishwar.
Parthasarathi
Prabhu is here from San Francisco. Thank you. Two cases, Hare Krishna. Sudeep Prabhu, two cases. Prabhu, your name? Sukadev Prabhu, two cases. Krishna Mahaprabhu, hiding behind the altar, two cases. I see one.
Manoj
Prabhu and Mataji, two. And Abhishek, two cases. Did I see one more hand back there? Yes, Satya Gopinath Prabhu. Thank you. One case? Two cases. Ashok Raula Prabhu, two cases.
How much is each case?
Each case is $108. There are 24 soft Bhagavad Gitas. Typically, these will go to many mortals. Colleges, hospitals, libraries, prisons, old age homes.
Actually, I feel each of you has a job. You say, I'll go. 2 to 10, anyone? Okay, you may say, well, I've done it before so many times. Another opportunity to get mercy. Any more?
I saw one hand here.
Balaram
Prabhu. One case. Varun Prabhu, two cases.
What about a young man from
Delhi? Trisha Prabhu, yeah, he did two. He's left two cases. One case, your name, Prabhu? Parth Prabhu. Jai Kanai Prabhu, one case. Malini Mataji, five cases. Radha Kripa Prabhu, two cases. Vijay Prabhu, one case. Vijay Gopal Krishna.
Ramai, two cases.
Ramai,
two cases.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Any more?
Satya Prabhu, two cases. Gopal Hari Prabhu, one case, he's traveling with Maharaj. Thank you, Prabhu.
Gopal Hari is actually, he's a professor, he's a PhD from Oxford. He's a professor of religion at Florida University. I'll get the name straight.
Bali Madan Prabhu, two cases.
Anyone else?
Jai Patel Prabhu, one case.
That's your one.
And I just heard two anonymous because Maharaj is here this weekend, so two anonymous. Two more responses.
They can text us also at 408.
Anybody else wants mercy?
Immediately two hands went up. Yes, Prabhu.
Vinay.
Two cases, Vinay Prabhu and Mataji, your name? Sonal.
Sonia.
Sonia. Hare Krishna. Two cases.
Bala
Prabhu, one case. Rukmini Mataji.
Five cases?
One case. Hari Sankirtan Prabhu one case.
Dharma. Krishna Dharma two cases.
Mayapur Bihari Prabhu two cases.
How many people haven't sponsored anything today so far? How many have sponsored so far? Who is writing now?
We haven't. I'll do 5 cases.
5 cases from Hansupriya.
If a lady can do 5 cases, then you men have to double it.
Trisha Prabhu, 2 cases for his family. Sridhar Prabhu, 2 cases. Two more. Sridhar from Pleasanton.
Yes.
1 case, Deepak Prabhu, 1 case.
Okay.
I'll do 2 cases.
So how many total cases, Secretary?
Siddhakata Prabhu, 1 case. Okay, by the time we count, we'll make a quick announcement.
One more.
Prabhu, your name?
Deepak.
Prabhu. One. Okay, let's speed in this process and let's all raise our hands. Geeta Mataji, 1 case. One case back at there. Name? Pooja Mataji. And one more here.
Ram Sundar
Prabhu, 2 cases. Aditya Prabhu, 1 case. Aditya Prabhu, 1 case.
We are at 76,
and
our goal was 100
today. 76? We are at 76.
And our goal was 100.
1 case, Devahuti Mataji.
Vrindavan Pier tomorrow. Because the marathon goes on, the Bhaktivinoda Thakur is appearing to say. So, deliberate to say. So, you have 2 more days to think about. Okay? If you decide to increase your contribution, or if you haven't given your name, you want to give it, you still have a chance. So, thank you very much.